So thank you very much for the introduction and for the opportunity to present our work on transplanted patients monitored for cardiac allograft vasculopathy and analyzing biventricular myocardial velocities and T2 relaxation times in this type of patients after heart transplant. So a little background about this issue that comes with heart transplant. We know that cardiac allograft vasculopathy is one of the main complications of post-cardiac transplant, particularly beyond the first year after transplant. And currently it's diagnosed, the gold standard techniques are coronary angiography plus or minus IVUS analysis to diagnose and to score the amount of allograft vasculopathy. And we have to address also that cardiac function has been added to as a criteria for scoring, particularly the CAV3 grade of cardiac allograft vasculopathy. So one thing I'd like to remind to ourselves is that CAV is not the typical coronary atherosclerotic process that involves coronary arteries after a certain age, but it's a different and specific process which has immunologic and non-immunologic origin. This is the current ISHLT grading system for coronary allograft vasculopathy. As you can see, it's based on angiography and it's based on particularly CAV3 status. It also includes cardiac function and restrictive physiology as one of the, as two of the criteria for this diagnosis. So about cardiac function, I presented these images just to highlight how cardiac function can be misleading sometimes if we only rely on that when we have the patient in front of us, because this is a patient A that was transplanted 2 years earlier and comes to our attention with this cardiac function. So we may think when we look at this cardiac function that this patient has a terribly coronary artery disease, but if we go and look at his coronary arteries are actually clean. And on the other hand, if we look at this beautiful heart function, left ventricular function, we may think that this patient has no coronary disease after heart transplant. But actually, when we look at the coronary arteries, we see these scary images that tell us that we don't have to immediately rely on cardiac function when we have the patient in front of us. So even at a glance, you can see that patient A was a CAV0 class and patient B was a CAV3 class, even if the cardiac function analysis could have suggested the opposite. So the aim of our study was using a multiparametric CMR, particularly including tissue phase mapping for quantifying myocardial velocities in systole and diastole, to detect structural and functional changes associated with CAV, to evaluate possible RV alteration that, we always say that RV is the most forgotten chamber in this, in many pathologies, including probably post-transplant follow-up. And to verify if there were any relationship between the CAV grade and myocardial structure and velocity alterations. So to do that, we used, structural analysis with T1, T2 mapping and CINE analysis in these patients and the tissue phase mapping to quantify myocardial velocity three-directionally in the, all patients. And a little reminder about tissue phase mapping. What is tissue phase mapping? Is a 2D phase contrast sequence with three-directional velocity encoding based on a spoiled gradient echo sequence. It's ECG prospectively gated and uses a velocity encoding of 25 centimeters per second. And it's performed in a three-slice fashion, base, mid, and apex, and we get the magnitude and the phase difference image after that, and we can extract global and segmental velocities, and particularly segmental velocities are reported in 16 plus 10 segments AHA model for all the segments of the right and left ventricle in systole and diastole. So methods. So we had these populations, 68 patients in CAV grade 0 to 3, compared with 18 controls. These are the demographics, and we can see that actually they differed a little bit significantly. I mean, about a BMI, which was higher in controls, and about heart rate, which was higher in transplanted patients, as we expected, because they lost vagal control on heart rate. So these are the data about volumes, analysis, right and left volumes. So our controls had higher left ventricular end-diastolic volume compared to CAV patients, and higher ejection fraction and stroke volume, actually, but the right ventricular and systolic volume was higher in CAV patients. So the results, so when we compare in terms of velocities and T1 and T2 mapping controls versus the entire CAV cohort, we saw that patients with coronary allograft vasculopathy had reduced biventricular longitudinal systolic velocities in the right and left ventricle, and particularly for the right ventricle, we noticed that also RV systolic radial velocity and RV systolic and diastolic twists were reduced on the right ventricles of patients with CAV disease. And globally, CAV patients had higher T2 also. When we compared groups, well, we noticed that at segmental level, we noticed that CAV zero patients had significantly higher T2 in several segments of the left ventricle. So we are talking about CAV zero patients compared to controls, so at very early stage of coronary allograft vasculopathy. But you can already see differences. And also a CAV two and three group, even if it was a small group, presented some segmental differences in T2 compared to CAV1 group. In terms of velocities, we also noticed that there was, between CAV0 group and controls, there was several segments that showed reduced systolic velocities in the left ventricle particularly, and in the longitudinal direction, and in the right ventricle in systole and diastole, even an higher number of segments showed reduced velocities. So what we concluded is that using global and segmental, using T2 and tissue phase mapping, we could already see differences in T2 and myocardial velocities, even at the very early stage of CAV, because we noticed that the main differences were between CAV0 and control group. And also another, you know, interesting fact that we noticed is that at early stage, the right ventricle seems to be more involved by reduction in myocardial velocity. So this forgotten chamber actually may be a very good target for systolic and diastolic velocity analysis in this type of patients. Thank you very much.
Thanks.
Thank you very much, Arthur.